Hello and welcome to Queer.
But here.
Today we are joined with Andrew.
Hi.
And Miss Stallard.
That sounds a bit formal, Miss Stallard, doesn't it?
It is a little bit. That's obviously who I am at school. I don't mind today if you guys want to call me Pam. I think that's probably a little bit easier.
I'm relieved because I don't want to call you Miss Stallard. It just gives me creeps thinking I have to talk to teachers again.
No, we're not that bad.
Well, these days you're not, but when I grew up it wasn't the same. Oh, our teachers wore gowns and looked scary, looked like bats.
I would love to walk around school in a gown.
Really?
Yeah, that would be brilliant. Stomp down the corridors, swishing like something out of Harry Potter.
Excellent.
Brilliant.
So, Andrew, would you like to explain what exactly you do?
I work here at Latest and I do lots of different things, apart from cleaning. Although I do that sometimes. I make TV shows, Latest, and produce TV shows, and I work for Latest magazine as the creative director. So over the years, I've worked as a designer mainly, but in the last few years, I've worked in television. And I suppose I'm the product of the art school system.
Interesting.
Well, you can see by the way I dress like an art student still.
David, do you have any questions?
Yeah, when did you come out?
I came out three times. I came out when I was at school, when I was 16, which was really painful and uncomfortable. And I was very, very lucky. I had a very understanding headmaster who looked after me, and that was great. And then I went to London to go to art school and discovered that art school wasn't the free and easy place I thought it was going to be. So I went back in the closet for a while, and then I came out when I was in my second year at Chelsea. And I went to a party and there was this absolutely gorgeous man. And I thought, yeah, that's for me tonight. So I sort of made a play for him and it passed on. It worked.
I think we all come out every day. That's the thing. Once you kind of come out the closet, you know, you think I'll come out and it'll be done. And actually, you still come out every single time you meet somebody new. You know, every time you start a new job, every time you meet a new person, you have to come out all over again. And you still never quite know what their reaction's going to be. You're always thinking, is it going to be positive? Is it going to be negative? And I think over the years, it's getting more and more and more positive, but you can still never quite be sure.
Yeah, I think that thing that we've all fought for, I mean, for a long time, me, called equality, we'll only ever have that when you actually don't go out and think, actually, I've got to come out again to these strangers.
Or when somebody turns around and you meet a new person, they go, well, hi, I'm straight.
That would be fun, wouldn't it?
That would be equality, because that would mean that everybody has to tell you who they fancy, rather than just the LGBTQ plus people.
Very true, very true. And by that, I don't mean the guys that you meet when you're out, or the women that you meet when you're out, that say, I'm straight, really.
Huh.
And we all know about them, don't we?
Yes, we do.
They're very troublesome.
So, when did you find out that you was, like, gay?
Looking back, I can't really think of a time when I ever thought that I was straight. I think I first started kind of thinking I might like girls when I was sort of about 13, 14, TV and film and stuff like that. And it was. I remember this big storyline in Coronation Street where there was a big gay kiss, and I kind of thought, oh, that makes a lot more sense than all the other kissing that I've seen on Coronation Street. And it kind of escalated from there. But I don't think I ever really looked at boys and went, oh, you could be the love of my life. Sorry.
I think, yeah.
I don't think men were ever there for me.
I think for me, because I grew up in the 60s, and it wasn't talked about. So you didn't even think about it as a teenager. All you knew was that there was something that was frowned upon, and it was called being queer. And I know we've reclaimed the word. But back then, it meant so many bad things. And above all, it was illegal. So you sort of shied away from it. So you didn't even think, possibly for a minute. Subconsciously, I might have been thinking, I think I'm more attractive. But I had girlfriends when I was a teenager. I mean, I think we all did. But I don't think it was because I thought I was straight. I think it was because conditioning just led you to think that that's what you had to do.
Yeah.
So I did it. Yeah, it's very different.
And I went to school just before the repeal of a thing called Section 28, if you guys have heard it. I think I've talked about it before, yeah. Where they weren't allowed, you know, according to the government, to talk about being gay or LGBT in school. And we had one teacher who still did. The guy who taught us music was an out gay man, and he talked about his partner, and he shared things with us that back then was probably illegal for him to share. And I remember looking at him and thinking, well, you know, you're doing just fine. So yeah. If this is the kind of the future that I'm walking into, then maybe I'll be all right as well. And I didn't know at the time that I would end up pretty much doing exactly the same thing as him, being a teacher and being out to the kids and advertising and not being scared, but here I am.
Yes, I was actually teaching at the time that it was becoming really difficult. And I can remember turning up, I was teaching at Kingston University, and turning up and being briefed on what we were no longer allowed to talk about. And it was like, at the time, I was working on a project with the kids all about awareness of HIV and AIDS. And then suddenly to be told you actually can't talk about all these things, really. And I'm thinking, how the hell do I do this project? And this is a really important project for these kids to be doing, because it was about awareness. And I just went in to see the Dean of Faculty and said, I'm not sure I can do this anymore. But I got into trouble a lot when I was teaching. I did a lot of visiting, lecturing as a designer. And I got sort of sent home from Farnham once because I turned up with a T-shirt that just said Queerers. And I won't say it live on television. But he said it was totally inappropriate for me to wear that T-shirt. And I said, I think that's really sad because I'm teaching visual communication. And it communicates a really strong story. Yeah.
It says it all.
Yeah. Good.
So who would you say, like, was your, like, I guess you could say inspiration?
Oh, for me, at the time, I mean, when I sort of really, really came out at Chelsea, it was Quentin Crisp, in a way. He was actually doing lectures at Chelsea by then. He was too old to model anymore. But he lived this incredibly flamboyant and out lifestyle. And just watching him was just like, I can do that. So I stopped worrying about looking outrageous and silly and fun, and sort of, I call it now, embraced my inner sissy, because I think it's great that you can be flamboyant and do things, you know. I mean, I'm wearing plaid today, so, and I've grown a beard, so I suppose I could be qualified as being a bit beary, but I'm not beary at all. You know, this is just another form of drag.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of the time, the way you live your life, you wear a sort of drag. It's a uniform. It's a costume.
I think every time you get up and you put your own clothes on, there's a certain amount of costuming going on there, especially with hair, with makeup, with the way that we design everything that this is.
Yeah.
Is the image that we're putting out to everybody else. And it's you know, where we horribly mask you guys for it at school, because everyone's in that exact same uniform all day, every day. And there's a limit to how much you can self-express.
Yeah.
But I think if I were to see you guys outside of school walking around town in your, you know, your best, smartest things all done up as much as you wanted to be, it'd probably be a very different image, right?
Yeah.
Yeah. It was inspiration.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that's a tricky one. I don't think I ever really had kind of LGBT inspiration. There weren't a lot of out women while I was growing up, not in the same way that you have now all over Twitter, all over Facebook and social media. There was Ellen, I guess. I don't think I'd necessarily say that Ellen was particularly an inspiration. And when I got to uni, I first met other actual LGBT people, and they started to be that inspiration for me. So you know, you sit down when you meet a new LGBT person, talk inevitably comes round to coming out stories. How did your family take it? How did you have your first relationship? How's it been going, basically? And I started to find my inspiration in their stories, because they would have been through things maybe that I'd been through as well, or been through things that were worse, or been through things that weren't so difficult. And every piece of their stories was something that I could take on board and say, well, that helps me to define my narrative as an LGBT person. And it's why even our group that we do on a Friday, it's so important that we share as much as we can, so that we can learn from each other.
Okay, so is there another question you would like to ask?
Do you know, how would you describe the word gay and what it means to be gay?
That's a big one.
I think that's too big words. It's too big a question, really. I think we probably spend another 11 minutes just talking about that. And maybe we have to go to a break first.
Maybe.
Can we think about it over the break and come back to it?
I might need a drink. Let's talk about it when we get back.
I believe it was on the topic of
defining what gay is.
Yeah.
I think for me, gay goes back to being 20-ish and recognising my own sexuality and being comfortable with it, and then actually realising that it didn't actually define me as a person. It was just part of me.
Yeah.
I think for me it's very similar. It's going back to about 20 and really getting comfy with it as a label. And I didn't for ages. I was always about lesbian, and gay was a boy thing.
Yeah.
And now, today, I would say that I define it as being just part of that huge acronym that could go on forever. You know, LGBTQ+IA. However we go into it, it's basically just that umbrella term to describe all of us. So I think that's how I would define it now.
It's a useful thing, but I think it's important to not be defined by it. It's just a part of the life I live. You know, and I want to get to a point where people aren't really interested in it. You know, that's the truth about equality in a way. You sort of want to get to the point where you just go out and you're you.
Yeah. But we don't have gay bars and not gay bars, we just have bars.
Well, look, one of the nice things about being here in Brighton is the fact that the bars are so mixed these days. I mean, there are still some that are a little bit scarily one thing or another, but on the whole, the bars are really nicely mixed these days.
I think you definitely get a very different atmosphere down this end of town.
Yeah.
On a Saturday night than you do very true. At the other end of town, though. I know which one I prefer to. Like, it's a fair few years off for you guys, but...
Yeah. Yeah, don't start going to bars yet.
Oh, not yet.
No. So...
David?
Pardon?
Any questions?
Sorry. How did your parents react to you coming out?
Ooh. Well, the biggest part of my coming out story, I originally told my mum when I was 14, didn't go so well, we kind of forgot about it. And then when I was 19, I was in my second year at uni and I came home for my brother's wedding with somebody I was going out with at the time, disguised as a friend from uni. And what I didn't expect was my brand new sister-in-law to come up to me over the course of the evening, drunkenly telling me that, oh, Pam, you might want to talk to your dad. Just told him you're gay. And later on, about my mum, and my brother, and my sister. So, yeah, that was fun.
So you were outed by your sister-in-law.
I was so outed, so thrown unwillingly out of the closet. It wasn't a dream, but they are now, like, my biggest supporters. Like, my mum is very okay now. So it all ended up all right.
My parents were great, but I'd always thought that they would be great because they were pretty cool and very young. When I was young, they were still very young. You know, they had parties that I would have liked to have been at. They were great fun. But it built in me a sort of fear that they would react differently and go against what I believed about them. And I sort of lived in fear. And I've always said that I think it's easier to come out if you hate your parents because you can, you know, you stick a couple of fingers up and
there's
say
no
that.
There's no fear of disappointing them, is there?
No. You can sort of turn around and say, well, I don't like you anyway, so I'm queer. But I didn't have to do that. I was really lucky. It was a very good time. I mean, there was a week or so that that wasn't. But it was, the whole thing was very funny coming to my parents, because I'd been home for a break. They lived in this tiny farmhouse on the mountain just outside Hay-on-Wye. Mm-hmm. So it was really isolated. And for the whole week I was there, I was playing Scrabble with Mum and listening to Radio 4. Every single play was about gay issues. You know, they were always about lesbian nuns and naughty priests and so on. And we play Scrabble. I still play Scrabble every day with my mum, and the only words I could make were bum and penis and queer. And, you know, you become obsessed with this thing, and you've gone home because you want to tell them.
Yeah.
And on the last day, I thought, I've got to tell them today. And it was Sunday morning. We were peeling potatoes and roasting beef and all this stuff. And you could hear cars approaching their house from miles away because it was so isolated. And we could hear a car coming up the lane. And I was just like, who's coming? No one's due to come. And as it approached, we realised it was my Auntie Margaret and Uncle Jack. So my plan to tell them over lunch was completely thwarted. And I went home. I drove back to London in tears because I hadn't done it.
Oh, no.
And then blurted it out on the telephone when I got home. So it wasn't what I'd planned.
I'm not sure anyone's coming out story ever is. You know, I don't think it's ever that lovely scene from Dear Simon. Love Simon, where it's, you know, it's all emotional and you get the perfect message across and everyone's happy and everyone's cool with it.
I love it on television when they always turn around and say, well, I've always known, dear. And you think, you know, I mean, my mum thought my brother was gay and I was straight. That's how weird they are, parents.
All right, so what made you want to help the LGBT plus community?
Oh, well, it all sort of exploded last year. And you guys, I guess, because these guys are year sevens, so you wouldn't have been here kind of around this time last year. Somebody comes to me and they say that we've been hearing loads and loads of homophobic language being used at school. People saying that's so gay, people calling people gay when actually they mean something entirely different.
Yeah.
And it snowballed from there. Myself and another teacher said, well, let's give some assemblies, let's say to people, we don't like the use of this language. And at the time, we were doing a monthly group, and that, again, it just exploded. But people were saying, we want the support, we want to sit and chat to each other, we want that social side of it. And as soon as that started happening, I started realising that it would have been so useful for me when I was at school to have had a group like you guys have.
Yeah.
And after that, I was completely addicted, couldn't stop. Now every Friday you will walk in, I'm like, oh, this is the best bit of my week, I forgot.
I have total envy, because when I was at school, there was nothing like this at all. And there were not even any teachers. Until I was in the sixth form, there were no teachers that you could have actually gone to and confided in, apart from my headmaster. And it was just a very, very different environment. I mean, these days, you're so blessed to have people who are prepared to stand up and say, listen, this is something we need to deal with. From the minute you hit puberty, it's not... Oh, and before. Because for a lot of kids, it happens when they're much younger. They recognise that they are not heteronormative.
Uh-huh.
And I think it's really important that it's recognised now. And I worry at the moment that the education system is being put once again under the horrific pressure that we had with Clause 28, with schools being told that they can't actually teach inclusion in the way that they are being told.
Yep.
And the power of a certain factor in the community to actually spoil things in that way. It must be very worrying for you.
We could talk forever about what's been going on in Birmingham.
Absolutely.
So I worked for a few years. I worked in Birmingham, and I was never out at school there.
Mm.
Not to a single student, to barely any staff, because it didn't feel like a safe environment. So when I upped and said, right, I'm moving to Brighton, I'm moving to gay capital of the world, and I will be out from the minute I walk into that school. And I still wasn't. It still took me time. But I love how out I'm able to be at school now.
Yeah.
Mm. It's hugely liberating.
Yeah. Do you still think children in the LGBTQ plus community are vulnerable to this kind of homophobia and things like that?
Unfortunately, yes.
Yeah, absolutely.
Horribly so. And I think maybe more vulnerable because people who have terrible opinions voice them on the internet where they can hide. They don't have to say it face-to-face anymore.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that's very powerful and very wrong. I think also there are a lot of people, young people, who move to communities like Brighton because they perceive that this is the crock of gold at the end of that yellow brick road, the rainbow, mm-hmm. and they're going to be really safe here. And unfortunately, there are predators and there are manipulators and there are people who will exploit young people, and particularly young people who come down here thinking that it's going to be great, you know, the streets are paved with rainbows and you're going to have a fabulous time, and actually they end up being homeless and falling into the traps of drug abuse and being used as drug ambassadors for young people, and also falling into sex trade.
Yep.
And there are men and women out there who will exploit not just gay men and women, but straight men and women who will take advantage of vulnerable young people. I think it's really important at the same time as we're saying these things, because we're talking about the downside of being gay, we have a great life, don't we?
It's pretty good.
You know, I mean, we have such good fun because we're open, we're open-minded, we know how to have a party.
Yep.
We're more respectful of people's human rights because we fought for our own human rights.
Yeah. Yeah.
And those are really important things. And I think if you are, you know, in any way LGBTQ, whatever, to know that people have fought for those rights for you gives you the freedom to explore those rights.
100%. And as a final, I don't want us to forget our allies either, you know, especially up at Longhill and even here in this room. We have some incredible human beings who support all of our LGBTQ plus rights as allies, and it is incredibly powerful to have them on side too. They're really important.
And it's been really exciting for me working with the school and your group doing this project, because I had no awareness of how strong a group you were. So it's been really exciting and really good fun. And I love you all.
Well, thank you for having us.
It's been great.
All right, that's it for today. Hope you have a good day. Bye. The bottom line.